such a beautiful prelude. Let's give Wally a round of applause. So, are there any announcements this morning? Yes, Debbie.
The Helping Hands car wash is finished, and I believe that we made $72 this time around. So we'll wait, and we'll put that out again probably in the fall.
Okay.
So people can get them for like winter and Christmas gifts.
Yes, Helping Hands car wash, we'll revisit that in the fall. Great Christmas gifts. Keep the salt off your car and whatever. Any new prayer concerns? Well, I have some prayers of thanksgiving. I'd like to say Marie Tompkins is home, and we'll continue her recovery there, so it's always better to recover at home. So thank the Lord for that. Also, Judy Gross Johnson is doing well, and she will soon be taking a trip to Florida to see her son, who will be there from Thailand. So he will be going to Florida. And Darlene Stanton was in the hospital, but is now back at home. And will continue her recovery from home. So please keep her in your prayers. And keep our community in your prayers for all those in need. Any additional prayers? Well, in that case, always my pleasure to introduce Reverend Barbara Morgan to lead us in worship today.
Thank you.
Thank
you. It's always my pleasure to be here. If I don't step on things so that I can't get up here. Okay, now, there are two switches here. If I hit the wrong one, we go. There we go. Okay. I didn't want to leave that on because I forgot to put it in the I didn't forget to put it on the charger. I couldn't find the charger. Which made it even worse because I've been all my thinking if it dies when the thing comes up. Which is right, I've left. Yeah. It's good to be here. The weather outside is gorgeous today. Everybody will get outside and enjoy some of the We begin our worship this morning with these words. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Let's pray. Appear to us again, risen Savior, for we have lost sight of you. We have come to find you here so that we can recognize you among all who suffer. We seek wisdom and revelation to cope with the confusion we face every day. We are here to remember the authority with which you spoke, so that we may walk with the rulers of our day, seeking that same authority that is established only in you. We who seek to be your body in the church need your eyes and ears, and need you to be eyes of our heart, as once again we embrace you and hope to follow through and find your joy. Amen. Together, let us read our call to worship. Come to worship God whose love was revealed in Jesus. Let all the ends of the earth turn to our God.
We will worship the Almighty in His praise. We will proclaim good news to others.
Beloved, we are called to love as God loved us. We are to love one another as sisters and brothers.
Everyone who loves is born of God.
Remember that you have been baptized. God claims you and has high expectations for you.
Christ is the vine, we are the branches. We will bear fruit when we abide in the vine.
And, while I'm having tea for us, and it's going to be familiar with, pass it on.
Thank you.
I like that very, very much. The words are beautiful. And after you've had those words, you don't need to just preach it somewhere because it's up there. Understand or they may reject. Help us to take chances by doing good to those who have not done good to us. Help us to be faithful and desire to increase your glory and your goodness in the world. Make us people who share in both word and deed that which you have given to us. We pray for the church here and all over the world, that it may encourage all the members to discover, develop, and use all of their gifts, those of nature and those of grace. We pray for those who are poor in body and soul, for those who are oppressed and heavy laden, for those who are sick or in despair. Minister by your Spirit and by us to all those whom we have prayed, and help us to walk faithfully in the path of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Scripture that the eunuch was reading.
He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent. So he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from this earth. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with that very passage in scripture, and he told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, here is water. What can stand in the way of my being baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he replied, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way, rejoicing. Philip, however, appeared. At Lazarus and traveled on, preaching the gospel in all the towns that he met until Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. When I read this passage from Acts this morning, I'm filled with some very conflicting feelings. Philip was guided by an angel to the chariot of the Ethiopian eunuch. He hopped a ride. Now, I have to imagine that as he hopped that ride, they probably exchanged a few greetings first. But after that, the eunuch looked at, and Philip looked at the eunuch and he said, what are you reading? And the eunuch had the answer. He was reading the Bible. And he knew what passage he was reading. It was the book of Isaiah. And he wasn't having any luck with understanding it. And I think some of us have probably been able to share that same feeling. But here's where I get to my point. What do we understand unless someone explains it to us? Philip was in a perfect spot. The eunuch was reading. He knew what he was looking for. And right away, there was his opportunity to reach out to the eunuch. It was a marvelous opportunity. If you ever tried to reach out to someone, have you ever had someone sit there and say, well, I'm reading the Bible right here, tell me what it means. Doesn't you normally work that way? Discipleship would be so easy if it did. But this is discipleship. This is evangelism at its height. Perfect evangelism. Now, this is where I get in trouble. Because when I think of evangelism, I think of somebody going out and knocking on the door and reading the Bible, or attend revival meetings, or something very out there. Not that it's wrong, but it's very out there. And it's something that I know that I can't do, and that I can't reach out there in that way. If you can, God bless you, because it's wonderful. But I've got to come back to at least one word here. But that isn't always the way we find people, and it isn't always what we see. I spent 25 years at First Church working with the people in the community. My title is Outreach Worker. Beautiful, okay? We had a number of people coming to the food pantry, probably 60 to 70 families a week. And after I was there for began to realize that they were coming for food, but they were hungry for more than food. And I didn't know how to address that hunger. So I went to pastors in four different denominations, and I said, okay, I know these people are hungry. How do we satisfy that hunger? And the person said, well, I could sit in the chapel and they might come and talk to me. Okay. Another one said, I have all these pamphlets in the back of my church that nobody takes. You could have those and they could use them. If you're not going to get them taken in church, do you think people are just going to pick them up here? And then the third had a marvelous idea. He said, well, train your volunteers with Bible verses and they can recite them to them when they come in for food. Now, I don't know about you, but I knew that wasn't going to fly. So I had to take the little red hand approach, and I said, okay, if you can't help me do it, then I will have to do it myself. So I started, and I read books, and I took courses in pastoral counseling, and I took courses in scripture, and I took more courses in pastoral counseling, and I took more courses in scripture, and I ended up with a master's in divinity. I can stand here and I can preach to you on Sunday morning and not have a problem with that. But it didn't bring me any closer to meeting the needs that I was seeing out there on the street. If they came to me and said, can you tell me what this means? I would have been fine. But just going up to them and saying, hey, this is what you need and this is what I'm going to give you, it didn't work. But there were still all these people who would come up to me and thank me when I wasn't giving them even the food that they wanted. So there was something that they were getting, but there was something there. And I thought, how do you meet that need? How do you take that next step? Well, I went back to myself. And when I was growing up, how did I find what I needed? Now, I wanted to understand that. You have to realize that I grew up in a house, there was no Bible. The Bible did not exist in my house. My aunt had a Bible on her coffee table, and she read it regularly. And I wanted so much to read that book. But I knew if I did, my mother would have a fit, and I wouldn't get to visit my aunt again. So I didn't. Until I got to EU about 12 or 13, and would take the bus by myself, and I went to a used bookstore. And all my friends were looking for those books that had all those nice little comments in them that you weren't supposed to read. I bought myself a Bible. I bought myself a King James Bible. It was very difficult for me to understand at that point. I had that Bible for years. I would look at it from time to time and try to figure it out. It hid underneath my bed because I knew it couldn't be discovered. But there was something that was happening there. And then the next time that I remember something happening was I was meeting with my daughter's kindergarten teacher. And I can't remember the rest of the conversation, but I know at one point she said to me, and I know that I'm saved and I'm going to heaven. Well, I'd never heard anything like that before. It didn't make sense to me, but it sounded wonderful. Now, probably that was the point when I should have reached out and asked some questions. But this teacher wasn't giving me any more information, and I wasn't in a position to feel comfortable asking, so I didn't. But I looked at the two of them, and I looked at those examples, and I realized, they were really being disciples. They weren't giving me the answers I wanted. They were giving me the spark so that I could begin to look for those answers myself. When we look at discipleship, it doesn't mean we have to go out and knock on doors and preach the Bible to everybody we meet. One of the authors that I love very much says sometimes that takes and drives as many people away as it brings in. Because it isn't necessarily a to represent God and what God stands for to those that we meet, no matter where we meet them. It doesn't mean we have to do anything other than be the best self that we can make ourselves be. Don't have to say an awful lot. Sometimes you don't have to say anything. Matter of fact, there's a wonderful line from St. Francis of Assisi that says, preach the gospel always. Use words only when necessary. That could put me out of business, real quick. But that is it. But it has a real sentiment to it. Follow that thing here this morning. Well, he said to me, you know, it's a good thing when you have papers, but you don't follow them, because that's what it's all about. Well, I can guarantee I haven't followed anything this morning. Not Wally. Rusty. No. See, I don't even know why this morning. So I guess what I'm saying is our job is to be the best disciples we know how to be. We're here. We are here to hear Scripture. I hope we all go home and read Scripture, study Scripture for our own benefit, not necessarily for the benefit of everybody else. But you know, if that light is there, if that spark that we're hearing about in that song this morning, if that spark is ignited, we're doing the work that we're supposed to do, and we're passing it on. And that's exactly what we're expected to do. We try to make evangelism and discipleship into something super difficult that we look at, somebody else should be doing that, not me. But no, we're all to be doing it. We're all to be the best person that we can possibly be. And share just the light of that and the knowledge that you have with each and every one we meet. That's what a follower of Jesus does. That's what the follower of Jesus should be. Philip had it great because somebody gave him the opening with the Bible right in front of him. Most of us don't get that. But we can be ourselves. And we can let God's life shine through us. Not to the one by the power within us is able to do far more than all we can ask or imagine. To God be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ forever and ever. Amen. Papers from there. I'm going to invite you now or remind you to leave your offerings if you have not done so at the end of the service. And I'm going to try and do something a little bit different with the communion service this morning.
Christ has obtained for us a life-giving
giving Holy Spirit, who unites us with all things, so we are to receive this supper in true life, mindful of the communion of saints. All those who have confessed their faith in Jesus Christ and are members of a Christian church are welcome at the Lord's table. Come, for all things are now ready. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
He is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord, our Creator, Almighty, and everlasting God. You created heaven with all its hosts and the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being, and preserve us by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending your Son into the world, Jesus Christ, the eternal Word made flesh for us and for our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God. With all your church and on earth and in heaven, and all the company in heaven, we worship and adore you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. In the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you as holy and living sacrifices. Together, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Grant that being united with him, together with him, we may attain the unity of the faith and grow up into all things in Christ our Lord. And as this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, and these cups from many vines into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your church may soon be united from the ends of the world into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus, on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me. The bread which we break is our communion in the body of Christ. Brothers and sisters, since the Lord has now fed us at his table, let us praise God's holy name with heartfelt thanksgiving. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is in me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who feels all your distress. Who redeems you from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast glory. The Lord is merciful and gracious to you, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor requite us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love to those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him, who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, and will also give us all things through him. Therefore shall my mouth and heart show forth the praise of our Lord Jesus Christ from this time forward forever. Amen.
Amen.
Wow.
Thank you.
May your touch bring healing. Let your actions count for justice. Be a sign of hope and a beacon of joy. Go, and may God's blessing go with you now and forever as you march out of here. Goodbye. Good night.
Goodbye.